incorporate interdisciplinary studies into all of our classes. I know as a Tanakh teacher, I often will bring in other disciplines so that students are able to understand how the Tanakh informs different disciplines that they are engaging in their other classes. And we not only do that in our Judaic studies courses, but we do that in our secular courses as well. Initially, Mrs. Besser prepared this lesson as an integration unit within the English classes. So she wanted to show through the literary studies within our English department how we can integrate these literary themes with Tanakh and with Jewish studies in general.
Hi, everyone. I'm Rachel Besser. So nice to see everyone here. So today we're going to be talking about one of my favorite books of Tanakh, which is the book of Kohelet. And one of the reasons it is one of the most enjoyable books to learn is because it's so rich, it has so much depth, and any time I look at it, it seems to just exude a different approach or different ideas. So this is one approach to Kohelet, and what we're going to be speaking about today is, can we look at Ecclesiastes, the book of Kohelet, as the first modernist writer? Now let me just take a step back and talk about what is modernism. It's going to be something we're going to discuss today in the lecture, but just very, very briefly, modernism is a genre of writing. It was very popular in the late 1800s and the early 1900s, around World War I time, and it has a certain feel to it. It has a lot of literary aspects, but the certain feel to modernism is that it's very pessimistic. Modernist writers were not cheerful, they were not happy, and they basically thought that the world had no purpose and no meaning and everything was just sad and depressing. And actually, Kohelet has a certain refrain, Hevel havalim amar Kohelet, Hevel havalim hakol hevel. Futility, futility, says Ecclesiastes, futility, futility, there is no purpose to anything. Okay, so it's a great depressing way to start a sefer, and it's a very interesting refrain that we're going to be talking about. So perhaps Kohelet, with this somewhat pessimistic attitude, at least in the beginning, perhaps we could view Kohelet as a modernist writer, and maybe if we do view Kohelet as a modernist sefer, it would also open the book up to us in a certain way, where we can, once we can analyze it as a modernist text, it answers some other questions that come up about it as well, which we'll get to. But before we even talk about Kohelet and before we talk about modernism, I'd like to talk about some of the precursors to modernism. Because what was happening in literature was actually happening in all areas of the arts, in music, in art, in literature, in language. There was a certain movement in the 1800s, and I'd like to talk about that movement first, and then that will be kind of an introduction to what modernism is. So what we have here is a few notes from Beethoven's Fifth Symphony. And Beethoven's Fifth Symphony is very famous, it's very beautiful. I'll play it in a second, and I'm sure it will be very familiar to everyone, if not from the symphony itself, then for sure from every commercial that comes up with this music as the background. And Beethoven's Fifth Symphony is a very, it's a great example of the Baroque classical period. And here it is. Once in a while you find one with three.
and once in a while you find one with one. Most of them have two motives in the theme, and then the composer will play with them. But what makes it a good piece? Anyone want to answer?
Participation, encouraged.
Innovation.
Okay, so when you say innovation, what do you mean by that? Because actually it's pretty simple, no? It just keeps repeating itself.
No. It's a pattern that had not necessarily been used before in music.
Mm-hmm. So that's really interesting. What makes this piece amazing, what's your name?
Tova.
What Tova is saying is that what makes this piece amazing is its pattern and its use of patterns. And what I would just add to that is what this piece is very, very structured. It tells you, this is what I'm going to do, and then it goes and does it in this incredible way while still maintaining the same pattern, but not exactly the same pattern. So what Beethoven does is he builds on it. It would be as if I would come to you and say, I'm going to hire you now to paint the Sistine Chapel, the ceiling of the Sistine Chapel, but I'm only going to let you use orange and green, okay? So you would say, that's crazy, I can't do that. I need a range of colors. You'd say, no, let's see if you could do it with just orange and green, and let's say you could, right? Wow, so you'd be a genius. You'd be amazing, and that's what Beethoven did. He built this incredibly complicated piece with only one tiny little building block, and then he played with it, and he varied it, and he developed it. Now listen to it again. So that's the motive, and that's the repetition of the motive, that's the theme. Okay, now he's gonna start playing with it. So he's doing it higher, he's doing it faster. He's putting it in the foreground and the background. Novels, essays.
specific structure. And it was a loose structure, but novels tended to have a plot. Now you might say like, well, of course novels should have a plot, but that's just because that's what we're used to. Modernist writers, why are we so confined by plot? Or they have to, you know, follow, you know, what you learn when you're in elementary school, right? There's the climax and the anticlimax. There's a certain flow of a novel. And poetry especially, it needed to have a certain, let's say, rhythm, meter, and it also needed to have usually a message, an idea that was being taught. The modernist writers said, we're not comfortable with this idea. Why? Because what the modernist authors were doing was they were examining what is truth. And they would say, well, let's say I believe that, and we'll take something very simple. I believe that it's good to love. Right? Love is a positive thing. And I'll say, like, well, maybe it's not a positive thing. That's just my opinion. So I'm gonna preach something to you in my poem, but it's really only my opinion. So I'm gonna structure my poem based on this meaning, but maybe that whole meaning is wrong. Life is better than death, right? That's a pretty simple thing that most people would agree with. But the modernists said, well, maybe it's not true. Maybe life is not better than death. That's only your opinion. That's only because you have preconceived notions about life and death. So the only thing that I can tell you for sure is something that is. I can describe something to you. And again, I will put in a caveat that it's only my opinion of what I'm describing. It's my perception. You know, this is a table, but if I would describe a table to you, it's my perception of what the table is. I'm not giving you truth in its purest essential form. So the modernists wanted to grab onto truth. And they said, the only thing that I know to be true in its truest form is my feelings and what I perceive as true. And I will tell you that it's my perception of truth, and I won't try to give any structures of meaning in any way. It's just a quote about what poetry should be, but a poem should not mean, but be. The truest thing is something that is. Actually, I went to a fascinating exhibit in the Guggenheim a few years ago. It was called From El Greco to Picasso. And the exhibit put certain paintings of El Greco next to paintings of Picasso. And the El Greco painting was, you know, very classical, a woman with a rose or something. So you have a woman holding a rose, and it's as close to exact replica of who that model was and who that rose was as possible. And then Picasso's painting of woman, I don't know, I made this up, I don't know if he actually has a painting of woman with a rose, but they're all different paintings, was, you know, she had a triangle face and one eye, and the rose was, you know, really a blob, and she wasn't holding it. And what's going on here? Because Picasso is in the same way pushing away the structure of meaning. Meaning, you're telling me that this painting is truth. You're trying to replicate a scene that you saw. And I'm telling you, it's not even the scene. It's just your perception of the scene. So once we're perceiving the scene, we might as well be more true and tell you it's only my perception and tell that to you by not making it look like the scene that it is. So a lot of people were doing this in the 1800s. And some of the aspects of modernism that comes out of this is a characteristic of modernist literature. So number one is stream of consciousness. Because the modernists only felt that what they felt to be true was true, they would just tell you things as it occurred to them. Meaning I'm not confined by a plot anymore. I don't have to build up a character, and then what's going to happen, and now this happens, and then this happens. I'll just tell you things as they occur to me, because that's more true than telling you, you know, something in a way that's going to be more exciting to you. Exploration of the individual's mind and perception, as we spoke about. Disjointed timelines. They're not stuck to a certain time frame where things have to follow. A follows B follows C. But it can be all over the place, and we're going to go back, and we're going to go forward, because that's my perception of what happened. And the two last characteristics of modernism are pessimism and alienation of the individual from society. Now, why does that follow these types of characteristics? Because if we break down structures of meaning, then what joins us together anymore? The only thing I believe to be true is my own perception of the world. Then I'm breaking down ideas that tend to bring communities together. So if I will no longer necessarily say that life is better than death, it's very hard to join together with someone to promote life, right? People join together because they have common values, but the modernists don't necessarily believe in common values
It's my own perception and your own perception, and even if they match up somehow, they don't really match up, because it's only our own, we are each so individual, we're each seeking our own truth, and those truths can never be combined. So they became an alienation, there's no society. And the writing is very pessimistic, again, because what is optimism? Optimism is hope for the future. You have to hope in something, right? That there's a system of meaning that you hope will occur. If there's no such thing as a system of meaning, then there's very hard to be optimistic also. So this is characteristics of modernist literature. Now, why did this happen when it happened? So perhaps, and I actually spoke to Josh Gottlieb, Mr. Gottlieb, about this. He's a history teacher. We were talking about, you know, why did this happen when it happened in the late 1800s? And one thing that we discussed was perhaps that there was these big revolutions going on in the mid-1800s. Anyone want to identify the people on the board? Students in the back?
Einstein.
You know, everyone knows Einstein. It's a great picture of him, right? What was Einstein doing? Right, it was his theory of relativity in the beginning of the world of physics. Right? He was telling you that the way that you perceive the world to be working, it's not actually working like that. There's lots of things going on that you just don't understand, and you'll never understand them. You know, all these things that you kind of take for granted, gravity, right? Well, maybe it's not exactly the way that you think it is, right? Who's this, our friend over here? Right, Sigmund Freud. What's he telling everyone, right? You think you love your parents? You don't love your parents. They totally messed you up. You think you understand your brain? You don't understand your brain. There's all these unconscious things going on. You think that your family structure is secure? It's not. There's all these underlying tendencies going on. This was shocking to people the first time they hear this, the theory of psychoanalysis, that there, you have this unconscious and it's motivating you. And it was a breakdown of the family system. You know, the way the children feel about the parents and all these terrible things that the parents did to them when they were babies, right? Anyone else? This one? Okay, so over here we have Charles Darwin.
Okay, very good.
And what was he doing, right? You think you're a person, not a person. You're descended from apes. You think you understand your place in society? You think you understand the movement? You think you understand your religion? There's no religion. There's no such thing as a person in the image of God, right? People are descended from apes. And Karl Marx in the corner told us, you think you understand how society should work? Society is totally wrong. Society needs to function completely differently. And all these four people came at around the same time in the mid-1800s. So you can imagine how this shook up the people of the time, and it made people feel like, you know, maybe nothing's really true. Maybe everything, maybe what they say isn't true. But who knows anymore? Who knows what truth is? Maybe truth is only my perception of truth. And there is no such thing as a meaning or an ideal or a real idea that I can hold onto that's really true. And again, then when World War I came and there was just death everywhere, so that shook people who were already shaken up were shaken up even more. So perhaps the modernist writers and the composers and the artists came from a world that was really shaken up by ideas that were totally different than the way they were before. This is just an example of a very famous piece of modernist writing, and you'll see, I'll read it, you'll see a lot of these ideas expressed in the writings. Here we go. Suffer the extremes of emotion from this front to the lighthouse. That Mr. Ramsay excited in his children's rest by his mere presence, standing as now, lean as a knife, narrow as a blade, one grinning sarcastically, not only with the pleasure of disillusioning his son and casting ridicule upon his wife, who was 10 times better in every way than he was, James thought, but also with some secret conceit in his own accuracy of judgment. So what do you see here immediately? So very long sentences, right? Why is it such a long sentence? It's a stream of consciousness, right? It's James's stream of consciousness as he's thinking about the scene. He's not describing it the way a normal author would describe it. This is what he did. It's about how he perceives it. See, we have a breakdown of family, alienation from society, a breakdown of what anything, you know, what's true, the father being, you know, the father figure, father knows best. And this is the beginning of To the Lighthouse, which is one of the quintessential modernist works, Virginia Woolf being one of the quintessential modernist writers. There are some precursors to modernism as well. I see precursors, and then we're going to get to Kohelet. You can see sometimes some modernist tendencies exhibited in earlier works. You know, this one from Hamlet,
very famous passage from Hamlet. And I just want to point out, this in this passage, Hamlet, to be or not to be, that is the question. Nobody knows the rest of it, but nobody knows that part. Well, Hamlet is really a personal conclusion. What Hamlet is asking is a modernist question. To be or not to be, that's the question. He's not accepting that to be, to live, is better than not to be, than to die. And then he goes and examines it. And I just want to point out that how does Shakespeare portray this question? He portrays it through soliloquy, through a person's perception, through a speech. Now, there is no such thing as stream of consciousness in the time of Shakespeare. Nobody's writing like that. And anyway, Shakespeare only writes plays. But within a play, the closest you can get to stream of consciousness is to have a character just talk about to the audience about what they're feeling. And that's what Hamlet is doing. He's examining systems of meaning and breaking them down. Now, perhaps Kohelet, we can read Kohelet in the same way. Now, one of the big questions about Kohelet is, why do the psukim not relate to each other? Kohelet seems to be like someone took, you know, a whole bunch of psukim, cut them into little pieces, like, you know, those magnets that you stick on your fridge and you can make all different kinds of sentences from them. It's as if someone took a book, cut it up, and threw it on the floor, and like stitched it back together in random orders. Like, you'll have different topics in different psukim, and you'll even have different topics within the same pasuk, and he's talking back and forth and going from one topic to the next topic, and it doesn't even read as a poem. You know, sometimes poets will do that, they'll bring in different images, it's not a story. Kohelet's even beyond that. It's a story of a person's life, but it doesn't really make sense in the order. And the Mefarshim deal with this, and, you know, different people give different opinions. Why, you know, why is it in this order? Some modern interpretations that there are different voices speaking and they're kind of arguing against each other. That's why you have all different ideas. I think perhaps maybe a way that we can understand this in Kohelet is by reading it as a modernist text. Perhaps what Shlomo is doing in this text is he's examining systems of meaning. And the best way to break down systems of meaning is to use a stream of consciousness. That's why the modernist authors use it, because you only trust your own perceptions. So therefore you express it in your head. And we all know, like, when our thoughts are running in our head, they don't come in order. They come, you know, and this reminds me of this, which reminds me of this, which reminds this. Modernist writers will write it as it occurs to them because it's the most true. It's the only thing that I know is myself. So perhaps that would answer, it's a way of approaching Kohelet, that it's modernist. It's very, very early modernist, a precursor to modernist, but he's giving you, as he breaks down systems of meaning, he's giving you his own perceptions of the system of meaning. And here we have the pessimism of Kohelet, right? Pasuk Aleph. The first thing that he says is that there is no meaning. Right? The world is futile. I just want to pass out, these are, it comes from a book by David Kaden. Anyway, it's based on a short story. So maybe the book is called that first, though? Anyway, so that teacher has on his door the quote of like some great conqueror in the 10th century who basically said, you know, I am everything, I will last forever. And then the point is that nobody ever heard of him, and he probably was very famous when he was, you know, very rich and very powerful, but now nobody knows who it is. So Shlomo is commenting, right? You think that what you do in this world has such a big impact? It doesn't. That's not meaningful. The world will stand and your generation will just pass by. Then he goes on in Pasuk Vav, Holech al darom v'soveiv al tzafon, soveiv soveiv holech haruach, v'al svivo tav shavaruch. He's describing the wind. And he says the wind, the milah macha, the repeated word of this pasuk is the word soveiv, right? The wind goes round and round. It goes, you know, from one end to the other end, and it just keeps going in a circle. And this is supposed to be, this imagery personifies how the way Shlomo views the generations of people also, right? They just go round and round like the wind. They're so ephemeral. There's nothing really to them. There's nothing that's really strong or lasting about anybody. And then he goes on and he describes the rivers. Kol ha-nechalim hochim la-hayam. I'm in Pasuk Zion. Though all the rivers flow to the sea, v'hayam einenu malei. But they never filled the sea. He's describing the system of evaporation. It's the water system. He says, you know, those rivers, they float to the sea, but they don't ever fill the sea. No one ever gets what they want. No one's dreams are ever fulfilled. So then what's the point? Right? They just keep flowing and flowing. And then you know what happens again? They evaporate, they go to the mountains, and they float down, and the sea never gets filled. And then he says, "Kol hadivarim yegeim." All the words are tired. Lo yuchal ish ledaber. A person can't even speak. Lo tispa ayin lerot. An eye can never be fulfilled of sight. Lo tamalei ozem mishmoa. Said you'll never see as much as you want to see. You'll never hear as much as you want to hear. You'll never be able to fulfill the longings that people have that make them want to achieve completeness. In which case, says Shlomo, it's just not worth it. There's just no meaning. And it's just very interesting, by the way, if you take a look at what we just read, Shlomo just mentioned the four elements, right? The four earth, what's the band? Earth, wind, fire, water, right?
As a rhyme so rehearsing, have, as a rhyme rehearsing comes to you,
we have
the
Dor HaLev L'Dor Rav HaAretz L'Olam HaMedet, the world, the earth. Then you have the sun, which is fire. The sun shines and it goes back to its place and it shines there. Pasuk Vav, you have the wind, and Pasuk Zion, you have the water. So he basically is saying these four elements of creation. There was no purpose in creating the world. There's no purpose in even having the world by kind of showing that these four elements, they never reach their purpose. So how much more so people never reach a purpose? So this is a very modernist text. Then perhaps we really can understand why he's jumping back and forth between subjects. What I do is I made the different subjects different colors. So this is just a little clip from the end of Parak Aleph, from Parak Bet, where you see how he's jumping back and forth between topics. So the first one in yellow is his idea of acquisition. Maybe if I try to get so much money and I try to acquire things and I'll have things, that will give me some type of long-lastingness. And then he switches in the same pasuk. But maybe that's not it. No, it doesn't. That's not going to work because you know what? When I die, you can't take it with me, right? So he says, no. Well, now I'm going to switch to intellect. Maybe if I get really really smart, that will be my meaning, right? And I'll feel that the world is very meaningful. And then he says, you know what? That's not going to work either, because the smart person and the stupid person, they die the same way. So again, your intellect dies with you. So that's not going to work. And they said, well, you know, I'll go for hedonism, for simcha, right? I'll just be happy. I'll just enjoy my life. That will be the meaning that I'll find in my life. And he says, you know what? That's not going to work, because he says, well, it's so short. That pleasure. And again, when you die, so then like, what did you do? And what Shlomo's really struggling here is that death seems to change everything. Everything that we tried to build up, once you die, it's not there anymore. This is a very, very modernist type of thing to say that there's no meaning, because once you die,
everything is just over. And perhaps this stream of consciousness is really the best way that Shlomo can get across this idea of saying, well, this system of meaning doesn't work, and this system of meaning doesn't work, and I tried this, and I tried that, and none of them gave me this sense of completeness, because that's really what I want. This idea of all the rivers flow to the sea, but the sea is never full. Shlomo wants to be full. And when he defines as full, it's something that has a long lastingness. It has a presence after death, and he can't find anything that has this presence after death. And therefore, he says there's just no meaning in the world, and that's the purple. Everything is futility. There's no purpose for anything. And it seems to be, you know, if he would stop it here in Parakvet, that would be a modernist text. Because they would just say there's no purpose for everything. I just gave you my opinion. This is my experience, and now you understand me, and this is truth as I see it. So obviously Kohelet does not stop there in Parakvet, because ultimately he rejects modernist philosophy. And this is the last pasuk of Kohelet, where he says, I'm sorry, it's not on the source sheet. He says, so tamar hakol nishma, et ha'elokim yaredia into a tav shemor, hizeh kol ha'adam. It says, at the end of the day, you need to fear God and keep his mitzvot, because this is all that a person is. Ki et kol ma'aseh ha'elokim yaviv ha'mishpat, because every deed that a person does will be judged. Al kol ne'elam, everything that you think has disappeared, im tov v'im ra, it will be judged whether it is good or bad. Now, what you have here is the quintessential system of meaning, which is religion, right? If you're a modernist writer, you can't talk about tov and ra. There is no such thing as good and bad. It's your perception of good and your perception of bad. I'm not trying to influence anyone with that. I'm just telling you what I think and the way that it occurred to me. Here, this idea of God and the idea of mishpat, of judgment, is completely anti-modernist. Especially this idea that kol ma'aseh elokim yaviv ha'mishpat al kol ne'elam, that everything that disappears, it actually didn't disappear. So what Shlomo is doing within this one pasuk, so he's answering all of his questions. He says, you know what? Yes, I do die. My physical body dies, but there's one thing that doesn't die. That is the judgment of my actions. And that is a system of meaning that allows me somehow to escape death. I escape death by accepting God, because he doesn't die. Now, it's not that I can be God, which he kind of wanted to do in the beginning and not die. He says, but my actions don't die. They will be judged forever. How did he get to this? So what's his reasoning? So I want to just go to the sheet for a second and take a look at Parak Gimel, because he starts to talk about this Parak Gimel. And I've heard this approach to Parak Gimel from Rabbi Yitzchak Tversky. I don't know how many of you remember him. But he was a very important influence on me, was a very important teacher at Frisch. He left it on about like 7-8 years ago. This is the famous passage of Kohelet where, you know, a time to bend, a time to sow. And he starts off, l'kol zman, ve'et l'kol chayfetz tachat ha'shamayim. Everything has a time, and there's a time for everything under the sun. Eit laledet, ve'et lamut, right? Time to give birth and a time to die. Eid la ta, eid la korna to it. It's a time to plant and a time to uproot. Eid la ro, eid la po, a time to kill and a time to heal. Eid la frot, eid la no, a time to scatter and a time to build. And he goes on and gives all these wonderful, amazing examples of opposites, where it's a time to do one and a time to do other. And he goes, and then he finishes it in Pasuk Tet, Ma yitron ha'oseh ba'asher hu'amel. And what purpose is it to somebody who works? What's he saying here? How could he look at that list and say there's no purpose? So Rabbi Tversky explains as follows. We'll take the example of Lifrot Veit Livno. You build your beautiful building, right? You build your mansion that Shlomo, that he worked so hard to acquire. Then what happened? Time happens, and it erodes, and it breaks down. And then maybe you die, and then, like, really, within 100 years, that building's gone. So what was the point of building it? Same thing, eight laledet ve'eit lamut, time to give birth and a time to die. And that baby was born, then they die. So what was the purpose of the life of that person? Eight latat ve'eit lakorna to it, a time to plant, a time to uproot. So what was the purpose of that plant? Ein yitron la'adam ba'asher hu'amel, there's no purpose for anyone in what he does. And he thinks about it, and Shlomo says, but that's not true. It's not true to read these eights, these times, as having no purpose, because he goes on and he goes, Re'itiyatinyan asher natan elokin lubnei hadam la'anoko. I look at the world and it's a torture for man because he's not able to walk away with anything. And then he says, no, it's not true. He says, et hakol asa yafeh bi'ito. He uses the same word of eight, of time. He says, everything was done properly in its time. Gamet ha'olam natan bilibam. And you can read that gamet ha, if you look at the word that's missing above, you can read it as gamet ha'alein, everything that's disappeared, the same word that he uses at the ne'elam, or you could read it as olam, as a world. Natan bilibam, he put it in their hearts. Mibli asher lo yimsa ha'adam et ha'maseh, asher asa elokim be'rosh ba'atzum. As long as a person doesn't look for the primary reason the world is created, what's he saying here? So Rabbi Tversky explains that he says he's first very depressed by looking at the world and saying, you know, poverty that we were dealing with in the 1800s, we're dealing with it now. And sickness that we were dealing with, we're still dealing with it. The human condition has not changed since time eternal. People still hurt and they still cry and they're sad and they live and they die and all the problems that we've had from the beginning of time, they are still our problems. And that's so upsetting because dor ha'lech b'dor ba ha'aretz le'olam omedet. Ultimately, that generation didn't change it and the next generation didn't change it. And you tried to cure poverty and you didn't cure poverty. And you tried to cure poverty and you didn't cure poverty. You tried to get rid of sickness to conquer death and you didn't do it. And I won't do it, says Shlomo. And that's so depressing. And then he says, but wait a second. When you built that building, it was lived in for 100 years before it was destroyed. And when you went and you did research and you helped found vaccines, right? Yeah, people still get sick, but they don't get sick as badly, and they don't get sick with that. So you've helped people. You've helped people have a reason. You help people live better. And yeah, you didn't cure poverty, but maybe you helped that one person live a better existence. He says, you know what? You have to change your mindset. You have to change and say, I'm not talking about the purpose of creation. I can't cure the human existence. But what can I do? I can do things properly in their time. Things that I do, there can be such a thing as good. Even if the good doesn't last, that doesn't mean it isn't good, because if I accept that people's feelings are important and people's experiences are important, even if they don't last, it still matters to them, then I can accept that there's a reason to do good in the world. And I can only accept that there's a reason for good if I can accept systems of meaning and I can accept that God exists. Because the only one who could determine good, it's not me. I can only have my own perceptions of good. But God can have real truth of what's good. And if I can somehow allow God to be God and me to be a person, I can allow God to rule the world and to be and to not die and to deal with what is meaningful in the world. And then I do my part as a person, try to make a little difference in somebody else because I value that person because they were created by God. I value your experience because you are, no matter who you are, you're still a child of God, and I have a purpose because God gave me a purpose. And that's what he says. Yadati ki ein tovam ki in l'smoch l'asot tov b'chayav in the next pasuk. A person has to enjoy what he has and to do good. And this is the first time that Shlomo really uses the word tov, that he accepts that there is good, because in the pasuk before he accepted that there is a God. And then he says, v'gam kol ha'adam she'yachol v'shata, a person who eats and drinks and has a very human existence, v'ra'ah tov b'chol amalo, again he uses the word tov, and he sees the good of his work, matat elokim, he believed that is a gift of God. Seeing good from your work is because you believe that there is such a thing as good, because God created a world for good. And then he goes back throughout the next prakim, and he goes back and forth between systems of meaning and not systems of meaning. He struggles with this idea of belief in the system of good and bad from God. And ultimately, he comes to this, Sof Davar, at the end of my whole statement, Hakol Nishma, Et Elohim Yarevi Et Mitzvotav Shemor, Kizeh Lo Ha'adam. It says you have to keep the mitzvot. God has declared what was good and what was bad, and he told it to you through the mitzvot. And then he finishes
in the last two perkim, and just back to the sheet, Kohelet Perakid Aleph, and he says, Shlach lach macha al pnei hamayim, very famous, Sukkim, cast your bread upon the water, throw your bread to the water, keep grov yamim timsa enu, you may find it in other days. He's cast your bread upon the water, according to all the mafarshim, seems to be a metaphor for giving charity. And Shlomo wasn't willing to give charity in the beginning. He was amassing his fortune because that was a system of meaning. He says, you know what? That's not meaningful. But helping somebody else have a better existence, that is meaningful. Cast your bread upon the water. Even though it'll disintegrate, you won't have it anymore, but that person had a better existence. Ki baruch hayamim timsa enu. That goodness will find you, meaning you're creating goodness in the world, and it will find you also. You're making the world better. Take your food and divide it into seven pieces, into eight pieces. You don't know when the evil will come. So save for the future. Help people. Think about your future. It's okay, your future is good. And then he says in Pasuk Gimel, Im yimol uha abim geshem al ha'aretz yarifu. Im yipol eitz batarom v'im batzapom makom sheyipol ha'eitz sham yiyu. So he says the following. He says, I can't control the rain, and I can't control the wind. Remember, he's going back to what he discussed in Parak Aleph, where the wind and the rain seem to be so swirling around that they gave him a sense of having no control. The physical world and the hurricanes and the disasters and poverty and the human condition, it helped him, it made him feel like, I have no control over anything. And then he says, you know what? When the clouds fill with rain, the rain will fall. I can't stop the rain. I have no power over the natural world. A tree that's been falling, I don't have power over the winds knocking down trees. What do I do have power over? Shomer ruach lo yizra, v'ro'eva avim lo yisor. A person who's a shomer ruach, who watches the wind. And he says, you know what, I'm going to find the best day to plant my seeds. Because if it's too windy, then my seeds will blow around and I'm not going to get the crops that I want. So a person, he says, I'm a shomer ruach, I'm going to watch that wind. And when I feel like it's the best day, that's when I'm going to plant. So Shlomo says, a shomer ruach lo yizra. You think you can control the wind? Can't control the wind, you'll never plant your seeds. V'ro'eva avim, someone who thinks he can control the rain, and he says, well, I have to find the best day to harvest because if it rains, it's going to ruin my harvest. That person, lo yitzor, he'll never harvest because Shlomo has now given up the control that he wanted of the physical world, the way that he wanted to have a lasting impression on the physical world and to conquer it in a certain way and not have his memory wiped away. He says, you know what? That's not my place. I give that to God. I can't control the hurricanes and I can't control the earthquakes. I can't even control that there will be poverty, that there will be sickness, that there will be dying. But what can I do? I can plant. I can do my part. Even if it's very small, that's what I can do. Because he's accepted a system of meaning, I can harvest. I can do that. I can create better things, even if it's just from my own experience and even if it won't last. And that's why, sorry, I'm going to show you the picture of the flower growing, because Shlomo realizes I can grow the flower. And that's why his ultimate rejection of modernism and acceptance of his system of meaning allows him to understand how he can experience the world in the way that Hashem wants him to experience the world. What is under his control, and what isn't under his control. When he tries to find the meaning of life, he finds that the meaning of life comes from within. It comes from good. It comes from understanding structure, that there is good, there is bad, and there is God, and therefore I can do good. Even if it's not necessarily the kind of good that I wanted to do, I wanted to do bigger good. So he says, no, but I can do some good. And that's how he closes his sefer, Sof Davar, Hol Nishma, Eta Elokim Yarevi, Adventot HaShemor, Kizeh Kol HaAdam. This is what a man can do. And so just to review, by reading Kohelet as a modernist text, I feel like it somehow can open up the sefer. It gives us an understanding both of the structure of the sefer, the stream of consciousness structure, and also why Shlomo is using that to describe the breaking down of the systems of meaning. And then when we see a very structured parak, like Parak Gimel with eight to do this and eight to do that, we see he's really coming back to structure. And by the end he says, without structure, you really can't experience anything meaningful, and therefore he once again embraces structure by the end of his sefer. Thank you so much, everyone, for coming. I just obviously have to end up that we you know, hopefully our, in the merit of our learning, bring a salvation to our sister Alba for offering.
Thank you very much, Mrs. Besser, for such a thought-provoking and multifaceted presentation. We have two upcoming events, one before Pesach, we're going to be having, we're going to be having a Hanukkah lunch and learn in early December, and we also are going to have our first meeting of our book club following Hanukkah on December 19th. Look forward to seeing you all there as well. Take care.
I don't know. I don't want to mess with it.
I don't either.
Oh, wait, no, I think the side over here.